8,000 acres have been designated a spotted owl wildlife reserve where any further logging was prohibited. But you'll see evidence of lots of prior logging. It became controversial because, you know, shortly after the Forest Service said, well, the fire has, you know, destroyed spotted owl habitat. It's no longer good for that, but it's still good for logging. And they proposed a salvage timber sale that, you know, many people were alarmed if you could just veto the spotted owl conservation strategy with a strike of a match, you know, commit arson and then get to log it. The whole plan was imperiled. So citizens rallied, and over the course of 5 years, opposing the timber sale, it actually went to court. We prevailed. It was the first time ever the court actually said, you know, the post-fire salvage timber sale was illegal for a number of reasons. But then Congress passed what was called the Salvage Logging Rider, suspended all laws protecting forests for about a year and a half. And people left the courtroom, went right up the hill. I don't know if you stopped and showed.
I forgot to stop on the way in. Yeah, I would
and too. Just set up camp in the middle of the road. She was one
of
them.
Did you notice it was the spot where the road was really narrow and you've got a cliff on this side, a drop on this side.
Oh, yeah. No place to go.
No place to go. And there they sat for the next 11 and a half months.
Wow.
Katya was
did
still.
Did people switch out at least?
Oh yeah.
It was continuously occupied, you know, nonviolent vigil. And
you may have seen the pictures, Eugene especially, of this wall, the drawbridge, and this giant fence and people on it with signs. It's quite the image.
So, I mean, they didn't just sat there though. They hiked this area, and we for a couple years led dozens of people, dozens of groups, I'd say hundreds cumulatively. At the very bottom of the hill, we actually set up a camp for a whole week and led hikes all week long in different parts of the burn, teaching people about fire ecology and, you know, the stakes of that issue. So it's this area attracted a lot of attention, and it became a kind of a national symbol of this debate over public lands management and what to do, you know, how to live with fire as a natural process. And this is a rare, rare place that no salvage logging was done. After a year of occupation, President Bill Clinton withdrew the timber sale and just said, it's too controversial. And it's been kind of thriving in benign neglect since then. The Forest Service has not done anything really in this area. So it'll be hard to sense, but when we start off the trail, we'll go about a mile. And this was the forest before the fire burn. So it's kind of a snapshot before. We're actually going to be paralleling the burn. The burn starts right here. So we'll be paralleling the fire. If we hike off trail, like 50 feet, there's the burn. So it's this kind of long comparison. Then we'll enter an area where, we're in the fire area. So it's a kind of a nice little comparing contrast of what was unburned, what was pre-burned, and then what's burned now. And what has come up in the last 20 years is I call it a jungle of natural vegetation recovery. It's really, the agency first thought it was a miracle of recovery. How did this happen? Because how did this happen without us? You know, having to log it, then plant it, then spray it, and, you know, do all this other intensive management thing. So it's really quite amazing.
Do they know if the spotted owl came back?
Well, that was really another issue. They surveyed the first spring after the fire. They had about 7 identified nesting pairs. 6 of them successfully fledged young, which is really remarkable, rate of success. And so we kept saying, wait a minute. If you're not certain whether a burned forest is still suitable spotted owl habitat, why don't you ask the real experts, the owls, okay, instead of your computer models or whatever. The spotted owl had barely been studied at that point. It was still a mysterious critter. So, yeah, it's amazing. And now since then, we've discovered that actually burned forests make great, you know, make very happy hunting grounds for the owl. It feeds their prey base. Squirrels and rodents, they come back very strong after a fire. So Any other quick questions? Because we'll walk and talk. Yeah, but while we get up there, you guys are all excited.
We can get out there.
Is that right here?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, so this area that we're in, I mean, the fire burned across the what's called the Corn Patch Inventory Rollis area. Now, where that name Corn Patch came from was this area was significant because it had this complex of meadows, natural meadows on mostly on the ridgetops. And the Native Americans actually harvested the bunch grass. They'd come up here in the fall and harvest it for all kinds of, you know, fiber needs, cordage, whatever. And they also, you know, party and do other things, trades, weddings, such things. But who really enjoys these meadows now are like deer and elk. And so this is pretty evident as a nice, you know, elk bedding area. And they come, you know, nibble and graze. It looks like we did miss most of the wildflowers, but still, we're outside the burn. The fire area is just through a rock. It's right paralleling to this trail. It's just, you know, here again is what the forest looked like before the fire. But by fighting fires for the last, you know, 50, 60 years up here, eventually these little baby trees are going to kind of encroach in, and many of these little meadows will disappear. And which are kind of an important ecosystem of their own. And so that's one, you know, benefit of the fire area. It kind of knocked back some of the baby trees and you know, kind of restored the natural meadows in some cases. In other cases, it stimulated the area, so we got a lot of new baby trees that came in from the fire. So a little mix. But anyway, so that's what we'll be seeing, a lot of the little small little patch meadows. That one is called Little Bunchgrass Meadows. On the opposite end of the fire, it is Big Bunchgrass Meadows, and that is an amazing giant meadow area. So, unburn, and lo and behold, look what we have here, fireweed, kind of greeting us, which is one of those pioneer plants that comes after a fire. But all that you can see here is in the fire. It's all down below us, over this first ridge, over the second ridge. On the opposite side of the valley is Cox Mountain. That's just outside the fire. The fire actually goes all the way up and over this ridge here. And, you know, the Black Creek kind of stopped the fire. You can see, and some of the trees are blocked away, but I see just the top of Bachelor Butte, and then this Broken Top. And then to the left there, you see the North and Middle Sister. But these trees are kind of in the way if you find a peephole. But
we get really clear views of those ridges later, though.
What's remarkable is we're standing right on the edge of what was a logging unit down here. In fact, this is a little cliff area. And so all these trees have grown in naturally since the fire. So it kind of gives a marker. There might have been a few, pretty much. They did plant a few of their burnt plantations down by the roadside. A lot of them were kind of failures for other reasons, but this came in from the seeds that fell adjacent or whatever was in the seed bed. So
this tree's really coning, huh?
Yeah. But you know, here's some snags still standing, and you'll see, you know, evidence of woodpeckers and all kinds of critters inhabit.
If you ever have someone try to tell you that clear cuts are important parts of the landscape because they mimic forest fires, you can see what a forest fire leaves behind out there in that complex, diverse landscape compared to a clear cut.
So yeah. You'd
be really confident when you tell them they're wrong.
Yeah. Yeah. Because the clear cut is devoid of any of these snags or logs, which are amazing wildlife habitat. And and even this tree here, it's burned all the way up. You know, scorch marks all the way up the trunk, but it's still got a green canopy. So
amazing.
Yeah.
And it hasn't flown down, even though it's right on the edge, right on the ridge.
Yeah. Beetles and carpenter ants, drives the proverbial timber beast crazy, you know. They're rotting, they're wasting. But they're kind of like the bottom of the food chain. And, you know, the insects attract things like birds, especially woodpeckers, who some of them are drill the first holes in, and then other critters follow and kind of approve. And so, you know, Jason pointed out that's the top half of this, and it's all hollowed out in there. And it's likely well hollowed up here. I mean, this is what's coming out. It might give you a continuous.
On this side, you can see the. All the little boring holes and sawdust, all the way, these critters hollowing it out, the whole thing through, all the way through. We have a tree with one of these that's about 10 times that size in our yard, and it's a 400-year-old live tree, and it's just got this massive sawdust mound at the bottom. You wonder how the tree survives.
Yeah.
What sort of critters doing that? I mean, like carpenter ants or beetles?
Yeah, both, probably. Yeah. And so it's. You know, it sounds odd, but so much wildlife inhabits dead trees. And maybe even a broader diversity of life inhabits dead trees. And you know, we have a kind of bias towards green trees, full of life and full of wildlife. But it kind of makes sense. I mean, we don't live in whole tree houses. We have to kind of saw up the wood and the planks to build homes. And so do, you know, the critters that, you know, need dead wood to be a little softened up a little bit and sculpted and excavated and you know, that's what a lot of the birds and squirrels and bats, you know, even bears, I mean, they crawl into some of these big hollows. Was really clear many years ago. This is unburned meadow. It's full of kind of dead thatch and stuff. And that was freshly burned meadow. And the grass was all really green, verdant. But now I can't really tell that distinction anymore. But what we're doing now is now we will be starting to enter the forest that was lightly burned. They call it an underburn, where the fire just kind of burns along the ground surface. Burning through dead limbs and logs and needles, and then occasionally we'll see where it, you know, burned up and or killed the trees overhead, and be much more bigger openings. Oh, just because there's fuel that, you know, it'll just, yeah, it especially like a steep slope, many times like a burning pine cone will roll downhill, or a tree will fall down, and sometimes it bobsleds all over. And so then it'll start fire there that'll burn back uphill, but yeah. They call them backing fires when they start backing down a hill. And they tend to burn less, you know, intensely than when fires are burning uphill. So yeah.
People fighting the fire?
There was.
And they were all on this ridge, right?
You know, maybe a couple thousand.
Yeah.
Over the 10 days, maybe a couple thousand, 2,500 is what I recall. The numbers are kind of fuzzy at this point. But,
but in general, I mean, big forest fires are economic boosts for communities, big time.
All the grocery stores in Oak Ridge.
A little more water for you.
Which is just another reason why people might think, well, maybe we should go out and light one.
Which is maybe exactly what that article is.
It's good for the economy.
Climate change, that might be a growth industry.
Yeah. Oh, wildfire. It's only like 100 acres or so less in size than Warner Creek. But at that time, it was before the court injunction on spotted owl, logging and spotted owl habitat. It was still a species of concern, and they had like what they called protected activity centers, PACs, is what they did. And so they would try to restrict some of their logging just in a tight circle around a nest. But a suspicious human-caused fire started the Shady Beach fire. They logged, I think the plan was 180 million board feet. They just hauled out there. and they logged all those packs. And the Register Guard did an expose once up. Front page cover photo, aerial photo, perfect unbroken green canopy. But it was in the fire area. It was underburned, as we're going to see. And at that time, they thought, well, if the scorch marks are 3 foot high, that tree is dead. It just doesn't know it yet. Okay, it's going to eventually die of disease or whatever. And so they just, you know, first year after the fire, they logged it and wiped out that spotted owl habitat. So this is just kind of speculation. But if the arson fire here was, you know, ignited by people who desire to salvage log what was then more restrictively an area more that kind of prohibited any further logging, the Shady Beach fire was a model. Ah, if you light it, you can log it. And that's just speculation, but.
What were the scorch marks on that live tree back there, about 50 feet up?
Oh, yeah. But within 3 years, you know, the second and third largest wildfire in the history of Lammet National Forest ignited either under suspicious circumstances or in, you know, even though it was clear it was arson from the beginning, that's what ultimately doomed the timber sale as the Forest Service tried to cover up the fact that it was arson. Because, you know, well, maybe it was, maybe it wasn't. It's an ongoing investigation. And the forest supervisor just basically lied to the public there. And the fire investigator had to come out and disclose, hey, wait a minute. I was there. I did this. I did the investigation. I handed it to him. It was an arson fire. It was clear from the first moment. But why it was ignited, that still is, you know, a mystery.
What was the first largest fire in the Lammet?
The first largest? Mm-hmm. Well, it's been burning since. Most of everything.
No, like you're saying, the second
here.
Largest and the third largest fire. So what was the biggest?
Oh, in the history of the Willamette National Forest, I think it's what's it called, the airport fire. It's up by right by Hoodoo.
Yes.
Yeah. And it's. I mean, it was back in the 40s.
And it went on 30s. And on and on.
Yeah. Now, of course, there's huge fires that have eclipsed the Warner Creek fire up in Walter Lake. There's been big fires over Willamette Pass, over Sandia Pass, the B&B fire, massive, 90,000 acres. So,
Tim,
yes.
Whose science determined that if it's burned 3 feet up, it's dead?
I don't know what their science was. It was just their kind of
forestry
model. Yeah. And, you know, in fact, that's true. Some trees that are burned can survive 10 years, but then, you know, insects and disease. And, you know, delayed mortality also has a kind of ecological value in those trees when they become habitat snags. But, you know, again, they logged over 100 million board feet in Shady Beach, just slicked areas right off here. Our slogan was, not one black stick. Nice comparison. Just 4 air miles apart, we have two fires relatively the same size, almost within the same, you know, very short time and distance from each other, a nice compare contrast of the different effects. And that might be one of
the Amtrak has a huge wind in here as it really starts to climb up the Cascades on that side. So you hear trains groan and whistles for like 20 minutes as they go through.
And actually, historically, the trains have started many fires at the base of the hill. They got their own fire engine train. It's giant things of water
and if it's the
water cannons and things, but they start a lot of fires.
I'm thinking of it goes around Mount
Just
Shasta.
Kicking rocks, shooting sparks, all that stuff. A lot of these snags are snaps. They've broken off, you know, midway up and fallen down. So half of them are snags, which is good for wildlife, and half of them are logs, which is good for wildlife. And what is remarkable about Kelsey Ridge is at the bottom here, we're just peeking down into it. About 400 acres of old growth that the fire kind of never got to. The forest itself was so moist and so, you know, dank.
Have a seat on it.
It put out the fire. So you want to see if dinosaurs still roam the earth, they'd be there.
Wait, which part?
Is that what they were?